In the 2000s, when 3D games were coming into form and controller layout wasn't standard yet, a melee-focused genre starting to emerge. At the time, I don't really think it had a name, but it would later be dubbed hack and slash. I know genres are kinda hard to define when you start to get into specifics, so I'll treat them like I do porn. I know it when I see it. Melee-focused, fast-paced action utilizing combos. When Devil May Cry 3 came out, it kinda cemented the gameplay. Games were different, but there were still similar styles and themes that carried on. But it's the games that came before that really interest me. Games trying to find their footing, or the footing that would later be standard. And the one that interests me is the one I keep wanting to come back to, not because it's great, but because you've seen this character before. From a magazine or a mention, this character at one point was almost up there as a poster child for gameplay. Three games under her belt, each different from the last. A few spin-off medias, some promo videos on G4, she had everything, and then next to nothing. It makes me curious, what was it like? What was the appeal, if any? And can it still stand the test of time compared to other titans of the genre? Well, maybe, maybe, let's find out. In the late 90s, Terminal Reality was founded, creating games that, from what I hear, were pretty competent. Some spaceflight simulators, 4x4 racing, but nothing that could really grasp for very long. Until in 1999, Nocturne, a survival horror game released only a year after Resident Evil perfected the genre. It utilized more platforming and action than Resident Evil, and because of that it had less polish, but still pretty ambitious for the time. It spawned a sequel in the form of a Blair Witch game, yes, that Blair Witch. A tie-in game for the movie was produced, but Terminal Reality took the creative liberty and made it take place within their own Nocturne universe as kind of a spin-off. But the thing to come out of Nocturne was a character named Spislana, a dual-wielding half-vampire, half-human character, aka Damp Fear. She helps the main character find the Holy Grail of Vampires, a stone that can make vampires immortal. The first act is them hunting it down in a German castle in the 1930s, and as the level ends, she double-crosses him and leaves him for dead. He's also kind of racist towards monsters, so you think this level would help him overcome that, but nope, goes nowhere. Makes it worse, actually. You never see the character again, but a follow-up to Nocturne was planned, rumored to be starring Spislana, but Terminal switched publishers and didn't want to hand over the rights. First of all, can I say how hard this was to install? I first used the Steam version and edited an INI file to get the widescreen running, but then the audio would cut out occasionally, it was going too fast, and not only that, but I wanted to play with a controller. I usually prefer keyboard and mouse, but for melee games like this, I wanted to use a gamepad. It uses direct input, and I had to use an X input files, and that worked, but the audio was still jacked. But I heard that the GOG version was better, so I waited for a sale and picked that up. And the audio was better, but controller support was still kinda whack. I couldn't use my Xbone controller and had to use my 360, but it wouldn't pick up my wireless adapter, so I had to use my wired, which is third party, so it's really stiff and kinda broken, but now I can finally play. When you start the game, you'll see you have two types of cutscenes. Full motion video, which look really good, although really compressed. Enjoy them while it lasts, because there's only three of them. The rest are these in-game cutscenes with little to no bone animation. Just walk cycles, turning around, and lip flaps. I don't think it would be that jarring if FMVs were so drastically different. It's like expectations reality. Not to mention the game obviously tries to do some fan service, but with how stiff the animation is, the breast physics just look so dumb. It's hilarious. I know it wasn't supposed to be taken seriously, but now it's even harder to try. Also, Rain herself is voiced by Laura Bailey.
That bitch. I'm gonna tear her apart.
Wanna know what she did before this?
You were talking to the girl who- the bathwater! I left it running again!
Oh, Blood Rain has a Japanese voice actor, Romy Park. Oh, I gotta find a connection. Well, Romy Park did Edward and Laura Bailey did Lust. Eh? Actually, Japan had a lot of publicity for this game. Even Famitsu gave it a 30 out of 40. Really? Everyone else just kinda gave it a 6 or 7. As for the story itself, it's obviously not the main focus, but it's there, and while it's not that good, it's surprisingly more prevalent than I first thought. Rain is an agent for the Brimstone Society, super secret organization that hunts supernatural. They had the same setup in Nocturne, I guess Spookhouse wasn't cool enough. The game is split into three chapters. Part 1 is when she's on her first mission with her mentor Mintz on the bayous of Louisiana. This is also where the tutorial starts. It's hard to explain, but the combat is kinda stiff. There's a spin kick you do by pressing jump on the way down, which can break down walls. The animation is so sudden, it's kinda hard to know where you are, and that might be me though, I'm kinda bad at 3D platformers. The melee combat is just kinda wailing, there's no real combos or lock-on, you just have an attack. At random, you see these kinda insta-kill moves she does, that's it. You can activate a blood rage, which is almost an insta-kill. If you attack while falling, you can do this, and guns just kinda auto-aim. It's here where I almost regretted using a controller because it feels more like a shooter than a hack and slash. Melee just feels like a backup since you pick up the guns the zombies have. Oh yeah, the zombies have guns. Even with this full arsenal, you really can't hold much. You can pick up a special weapon, which I guess is your most powerful. Either way, you run out of ammo pretty quickly. Reminds me of the Shadow Warrior remake, where they kinda wanted melee not just to be a throwaway weapon. It kinda shows the evolution of hack and slash. Like, developers went, hey, why don't we make hack and slash a more useful tool instead of your one and done weapon? You make your way through the swamps because water hurts you. Yeah, not holy water, just plain water. Narratively, it's weird, but it serves as an okay platforming challenge, but there are plenty of moments where it kinda confused me, like, am I supposed to go here? Fuck it, I'll just take damage. There's an outbreak turning people into zombies. If you have to take out these biomass nests that are making these monsters, it's kinda tedious, but blood range just makes everything easier. You meet a Creole with animation, and you get a new weapon, a hook that brings enemies closer. Oh yeah, I'm using a controller, but it has that old 1-2-3 button layout, so I had to have this image open my second monitor. The most unique mechanic is the blood sucking. Since you're half vampire, you can suck anyone's blood to heal yourself and kinda insta-kill them. If you're in mid-combat, you can just circle around and use them as a human shield. Sometimes they're nice enough to stop and wait. You'd think it would get a little OP, and it kind of is, we'll get there, but you still get damage pretty fast, so it feels kinda like a nice balance to me. I don't know how I survived that, but I'm going god mode. I will admit, there were some pretty tedious moments that made me want to just do that. Hey, don't blame me, the developers put it in there. Plus, look at this, how am I supposed to not take damage? The level design can be kind of basic, it's your standard point A, point B, attack thing, move on. There's even a power which can highlight your endpoint so you won't get lost. It's simple, but it has some detail. Like, there are these arrows to show if the goal is higher or lower than you. And I like the part where you need a battery for the elevator, and if you didn't notice the car, she won't give you the hint. The graphics themselves are pretty good for 2002. I mean, there wasn't much competition. What? Gothic? Rune? Again, my only problem is these cutscenes. Some of them depend on where you are, and other times it's so stiff it's just funny. I will say Laura Bailey's acting is really good.
Cute. That's the first thing you've ever said to me, Commando, and I've heard it all before. You need a better come-on.
She's really giving it her all, even when her Torahoru comes out. Although sound design could use some work, the screams and folding do seem kinda loud. Oh yeah, suck that blood, so hot. When you beat the first boss, which isn't too hard, just two sticks of dynamite and blood range, you find the villain behind it all. Nazis. I think. Whatever that swastika is supposed to be. Several years later, they're trying to find an artifact called the Skull of Belair. This is probably the same MacGuffin used in Nocturne. I'll be honest, the story isn't terrible, it's just not what I'm focusing on right now. When you get to Argentina, okay, you get a new power where you can slow down time. That's really all it does, but I'm a sucker for slow-mo, so I had fun with it. Also, it's not like Max Payne where you have a limit, you can do it however long you want. They introduce this hit list kinda, where they're not really bosses, or not really mini-bosses. This is kinda where the blood-sucking got a little OP, but it was still kinda hard to get to them. The game itself uses a checkpoint system, but you can save any time. I also completely forgot to record the part where you fight a Spanish priest that doubles as a KKK with a tank podium. How did I forget this? Some of the bosses can either be too easy like the first one, or way too cheap like the
that big blonde bitch.
Yeah, her. She has this, whoa, that's a nip slip. She likes to get on you and it's really hard to dodge, and then she opens the floor. At first I thought I was doing something wrong, but nope, that's just what you gotta do. Right as the floor dropped. The AI isn't the best, but I'm honestly not expecting much. The music in this level is really good. Very ambient industrial sound. Sometimes the music would kind of blend in, but there are some standouts, like this one that reminds me of Fear. The core of the temple is the trippiest level, but also one of the hardest. There's just so many enemies, and the platforming has so many eras, I kept falling off. I kept having to start over. Some parts have auto balance, but I'm still not good at third-person platformers. At least there's no fall damage. What's the point of having explosive barrels if I can't shoot? You always auto-aim. This is kind of where most of the challenge comes from. Not from the enemies themselves, but placement you're given. You're given arms and an arena, and they just tell you to go at it. While it's not a terrible level design, it just has moments that made me question it. Like, am I supposed to go this way? It doesn't feel like it. When you reach the crystal skull, which gives you a new power, to zoom in. I don't think I use this. The rest of the game takes place in these German castles, which are implied to be the same from Nocturne. A new cutscene, new assault rifles, some new jetpack enemies, new fertile vampire enemies. I think I was lost outside the castle for like 30 minutes. There's a level where you pilot a mech. It only lasts like 10 minutes and it just becomes you attack, he attacks game, and God mode doesn't work here. I'm not gonna show you everything in this game because I thought I had a laundry list of things to talk about, but looking back at the footage, I'm kinda struggling. It's very playable, but it's not a lot there. Like I said, it's just go here, kill that, repeat. You don't upgrade your attacks, you just get better damage. You get 4 power-ups, but they're kinda useless. The pieces are there, melee combat, some ranged weapons, platforming, health gimmick, that's it. There's not a lot of depth. But at the same time, it's this type of game design that makes me kinda like it. It came out in a time where video games were trying. They were doing their best just to be fun. The difficulty is not from any real challenge, but just from a lack of polish. I can't really blame it though. This is where action games were still testing the waters. It's a very rough game with a lot of jank, but it's competently made. It's very much playable. I don't think I can call Blood Rain a good game, but I had fun with it. There is still a lot of stuff I skimmed over. I would recommend it, but only if you know what you're getting into. It would be only 2 years later when Terminal Reality released a sequel. And when they say the sequel is better, they mean it. This is where the meat and potatoes are. The first game established the world, but this is where it expanded it. But firstly, installing it was a bit easier. There's a fan patch that lets you run on modern hardware, and it's highly customizable. It's got controller support, you can change the shadows, reflections, anti-aliasing, make the cutscenes higher quality, which turned out to be a bad thing. Still, this mod has a lot, although it still wouldn't start up for me at first until I realized that GOG puts the game in compatibility mode by default.
Gee, thanks.
I wanted to play in full screen resolution, and there is an option for horizontal stretching, but it doesn't quite work that well. Oh, that's unfortunate. That's not a lot of faith in hardware. I tried seeing if you could adjust the draw distance, but I couldn't find anything. I'm usually really picky about texture popping, but this didn't really seem to bother me for some reason. If it does for you, I'm sorry. But speaking of graphics, it's much better than the first. It has shine and polish, little details on the models, though when you zoom in it does start to get a little jaggy. The models themselves have been sexed up a bit. They got rid of the awkward jiggle physics unless you get a cheat code. Each level's got new groups of people with different mini skirts and bikinis. Yep, you couldn't make a game like this today.
Huh, so this is what you get when you give tax cuts to the top 1%.
Nope, can't make this anymore. The settings change, it's now cuts to the future in a contemporary 2000 setting. Awesome. Since it's the future, no one from the previous games return outside of Rain, so new characters like... Hold on a second. Blood. Rain. Wiki? Severin, your Cortana character that gives you your exposition before you enter an arena.
Zerx is like 3 down from the top. Do you ever read anything?
Fuck off!
And your villains have more screen time with personality, complete with voice acting that sounds like it's coming all from the throat.
Too bad, pretty. Would have been a pretty mess you made. Not so tough.
That I may stride my kingdom at will.
Does no one know how to vocal fry? Like, yeah, I can do this voice for 5 minutes. I'm not going to be a main character or anything. For real, though, the acting is pretty good. Each group of goons have a different actor, one of them being Nathan Vetterlin, the voice of Scout from TF2, and he goes above and beyond.
God damn, that bitch runs fast. There she like is. A crack legend. We're looking for a hot, thick-breasted, red-headed damn deer. Okay,
that's
there's not
heal.
Like 30 of them around here.
You know, what we need is one of, you know, a good restaurant. You know, something with like a buffet. You know, chicken, you know, mashed potatoes, you know, homestyle gravy.
Laura Bailey's back and has a lot more attitude and one-liners.
Can you tell the little bastard inside my skull to turn off his jackhammer?
She said she had a lot of fun voicing Rain, and if there was a line she didn't like to say, the director was more than happy to change it. So she had a little contribution to the character. The music is still pretty good with that orchestraic industrial, but it sounds like some songs are reused from the first game. There's also now 3 different types of cutscenes. The simple in-game scenes, the really good full motion video, and now an in-engine cutscenes that are pretty good if a little low quality. Sadly, my recording program didn't pick them up. The patch has an option to render the cutscenes at higher quality through an external media player. I thought, why not, but I recorded through the game, so I'm taking all these off of YouTube. Thanks,
Artemis.
Couldn't have done it without ya. The Brimstone Society is destroyed by the one Kagan, who also killed Rain's mother, apparently. She never got a chance to kill him herself, so for revenge, she hunts down Kagan's offspring. And he has a lot. Apparently. Even the wiki doesn't know who's who. It's not about that. The gameplay is a huge step up from the first. While the first game was more shooter with some melee combat, 2 goes the opposite. It's all melee and barely shooter. A proper hack and slash. Instead of mindlessly mashing melee, you now have dial combos similar to Ninja Gaiden with a high and low attack. You can unlock more as you progress through the game. You can use the joystick to perform some special moves like kind of a weapon spin attack. These were kind of hard to pull off, so I didn't really bother with them much. You have a lock-on feature and jump and dodge around them, just like in Devil May Cry. Although when I first played it, I kind of hated it because it kind of worked like the DMC reboot, where it would only lock on to whoever you're facing, not who you're closest to. Until near the end of the game, I discovered you can turn that on. God damn it. There's a kick which is supposed to stun enemies, but it feels like a weaker attack. Some enemies will have weapons, so if you want to drain them, you need to get rid of their weapon. If not, they're fucking clobber you. What does that look like the most violent move in the game? Rain has a good handful of guns. A single shot, rapid fire, shotgun, kind of a sticky grenade, flamethrower, and rocket launcher. The ammo for these is your health. In theory, this works as a way not to overuse your projectiles, but in practice, it's such a precious resource, I almost never use them unless I needed to, or go god mode. Your 4 special abilities binded to your D-pad now have 8, by double-clicking the direction of the D-pad, not including the objection marker power. A blood range that increases attacks like the first game, blood fury that's just more powerful, and blood storm that attacks nearby enemies. You can slow down time in the first game, also a speed time to move faster, but it doesn't actually speed her up, it just increases the field of view to give the illusion of speed, but I already had the resolution maxed out so nothing happens. She also has a ghost feed that can send out a ghost and drain blood for you, and ethranol that can possess people. I don't think I use this one, but the most used ability is her harpoon. Instead of stiff enemies coming towards you, you now have ragdolls that you can throw around with a physics engine. Yep, it's another Half-Life 2 killed my game. Actually, this came out just months before Half-Life 2. I think the physics in there are way better, but in here it's still the core focus. What, you think swinging around enemies and making them stick to walls is just a fun gimmick? It is, unless you're forced to. Can you say physics-based puzzles? Okay, not really puzzle, more like enemies endlessly spawn until you throw 3 of them into a furnace. You would think throwing them would be a simple flick of the stick, but it also depends on how close you are to the Earth's hemisphere, because I could not figure this the fuck out. I get hold harpoon, but then do it fast flick, or slowly move it, or back and forth like a whip? I had no idea. I'm sure there was a method to the madness and I was just mad. Okay, but these puzzles aren't really everywhere in the game. They're everywhere. I'm not kidding. This is half the game. Majority of the time, I'm just figuring out where I'm supposed to throw them. Some of these are fairly easy, like throw them in this one area, but sometimes it's the game's fault. Like throw them on this pipe and maybe he'll land. Or the boss at the end of a sewer level. Yeah, I had you at sewer level. The incest dragon throws suicide bombers at you and you have to shoot them as soon as it throws them, then turn on the water because vampires are H2O intolerant, so I have to keep filling up my health and not get hit by flying bombers, and when Rain gets hit, she gets knocked back in zero G. I'm just like, fuck this, I'm going god mode. There's also these one mini boss you have to kill by pushing these three barrels off, but if you time it wrong or push it at the wrong angle, it could just miss completely, and they're really spongy. Also, you have to fight them again without any physics puzzle. I can get how at the time this would seem fresh. Physics was a new thing, so it must have been really cool to see it play out, but most of this is just kinda tedious. In a lot of ways, Blood Rain 2 is an upgrade from the first. I can safely call it a hack and slash or character action, as there is character and some action, a combo-based attack system, much more weapons and abilities, more developed characters and fleshed out story, graphics are much better, but I still can't call it a good game. This came out at the same time Devil May Cry 3, God of War, Ninja Gaiden all basically perfected the genre. On its own, it's a fine game, but compared to other giants of the time, I don't think it can hold a candle. It has the same problems the first one did. The difficulty doesn't come from the gameplay, it comes from what surrounds it. The difficulty to perform special moves, you can't use most guns, some powers are kind of pointless, and not to mention the overabundance of physics-based puzzles that kinda don't age well. But I still liked it. Even with all the annoying faults, I had fun with it. Guilty pleasure, I guess. It's hard to explain, but it feels like the devs just wanted the player to have fun. I'd recommend it, not so much for the gameplay, but for everything else. The aesthetic, the levels, each area was something new. It felt like an adventure, a really dated one, but that was part of the charm. I take it as seriously as it takes itself. And from that, I had fun. After that, Blood Rain lived on in spin-offs. I don't quite know what happened. From what I gather, 2 seemed to have sold well, but nothing else came. It seems like Terminal Reality made some licensed games. The only one I played was Ghostbusters, which was pretty fun. There were a few cancelled games. There was gonna be a Blood Rain game on the PSP taking place right after 2 and featuring co-op multiplayer. A game called Blood Rain in the Shroud on the 3DS, but both were cancelled. Terminal Reality were also working on a game called Sundown in collaboration with Guillermo del Toro, but it looks like it never took off. Outside of video games, Blood Rain had a few comic book issues that ran from 2004 to 2008, published by not DC, not Marvel, not Image, but Digital Webbing. Who the fuck is- So Digital Webbing is a comic publishing company that began in 2001, and that's all I could find. From the looks of their YouTube channel and Skillshare website, it doesn't look like there's much. I think they own a total of 3 characters, including Blood Rain. They even had a crossover. I don't want to make fun of anyone. It looks like they have a Kickstarter for an issue or two, so I'll leave a link in the description. From what I've read, the comics range from pretty decent to below average in terms of licensed comics. The first 2 issues weren't great, but it was interesting how they were handled by different people, like Greg Horn and Christina Z. But after that, they seem to have gotten a team to work on the rest. It's sad because I like the idea of an episodic adventure written by different kind of people, like Hack Slash, but without the comedy, which I guess is the biggest flaw. It's riding on the back of overly edgy 90s comics, which are pretty bad for the most part, even though personally they're kind of a guilty pleasure. Overall, they're an okay read if you want extra Blood Rain, but it looks like they're out of print and it's pretty hard to get copies of them, so I guess I'll just give them away. Yeah, why not? Links in the description. Other than comics, there's also the movie trilogy! By Uwe Boll.
Thrall, my companion is gone. I don't know what's become of him.
I'm not watching that! It would be another 5 years until we had another mainline entry. But some don't even consider it to be one. Blood Rain Betrayal. Not developed by Terminal Reality, but by good old WayForward. I don't think these guys can make a bad game. Sure, there are some mediocre ones, but they have the talent to turn what would be an average shovelware for lackluster movie into something really playable. And if that's just shovelware, imagine the original games. Betrayal is a platformer, so it's new gameplay, but there's plenty to draw over. The graphics being hand-drawn really makes the background look really good. I love the depthless coloring, and everything has pure black shading. It makes it look like a Mike Mignola comic. The character models look nice with a light anime look to them, nice animations, but I think Rain herself looks kind of bland. It feels a little too safe. Her eyes look a bit off and the blade's just kind of awkwardly placed there. But in game, you can't tell that kind of stuff. Plot-wise, there's nothing really to write home. It's actually a prequel since you fight Kagan from 2, but not really because, you know, prequel. Brimstone Society hires Rain to take down the castle, and that's about it. Some other stuff happens, but, it's not even anime, it's like DeviantArt fanime. You go in and around the castle like an old school Castlevania game. Gameplay feels really smooth, but instead of pre-built dial combos, it's directional. Depending on where you point the joystick, you'll do a different type of move. You got an upward launch, launching sideways, stomp on the ground, trip kick, stuff like that. You can dash with invulnerability that the game doesn't tell you. You can still grab and heal, but it's much quicker, and if you quickly do it, you can turn into a bomb. Your pistol now uses ammo, but it's very limited, but enemies drop them. Pretty standard stuff, until you get to the backdash. You pull it off by turning around and jumping. As you quickly turn around, there's a little frame of animation that lasts like half a second. In that frame, you need to jump, and then you'll propel backwards. It's one of the weirdest moves in the game. There's not many times you'll run into it, but most of the time I was just struggling to pull it off. It's one of those things where I don't know if it's my fault or the game. I was playing the Steam version, but then I heard GOG copy adds an extra button. So I bought the GOG copy. Now I got the complete collection. The extra button makes it easier, but there's still some additional platforming that makes it really difficult. Like there are these red skulls you need to collect in order to get more health or more ammo, but they're in some pretty hard to reach places, and sometimes these won't respawn, so if you mess up, you have to reload the level. Just like 2, I feel like her knockback can get really annoying. Come to think of it, it's just like the other games. The real challenge comes not from the hack and slash elements, but from everything around it. In here, the platforming itself is not impossible, it's just really squished together. But it's still very playable.
Hey, this is me, in the future, sick, telling you about the awesome music in this game by Jake Kaufman. It's great, it's got a nice symphonic metal sound to it. You can get it for free off of his Bandcamp, there's even a cheat code where you can play it in 8-bit.
Overall, I like Betrayal. I like it on the same level I like 2, but for different reasons. Blood Rain 2 had a lot of gameplay options and a variety to work off of, but it lacked the polish to hold it all together. Betrayal has polish, it just doesn't have a lot of stuff. There's only so many enemies, you unlock all the combos about halfway through, there's no difficulty select, no costumes, no voice acting, there's not a lot of replay value. And it's sad because there's evidence of a really good game here. Apparently the publisher forced them to change art styles halfway through development and cut their staff in half. It's a fun game with a lot of flaws, but I don't think it's as bad as people say it is. I think it's just not a 3D game like people want it to be. It's a fine game, but it could have been better. And this is where I would usually end it, but as of this year, the Blood Rain property was bought by a new publisher, Ziggurat Interactive, and Terminal Reality remastered both games, dubbed the Terminal Cuts, with high textures, upscaled cutscenes, proper widescreen, controller support, all the works. As far as content goes, there doesn't seem like there's much new they added. The best thing this does is run on modern hardware, and really that's all I ask for. If you own the original games, you get these for free, so I'm happy. And it was just revealed that Betrayal was also getting a remaster too. Looking at the trailers, I don't know if there's much they're adding, but there's voice acting. Kagan doesn't sound like he's stabbing his throat.
You useless troops.
And Laura Bailey's back.
Did you miss me?
Baby, you ain't kidding.
While these games aren't great, I still had fun with them. And really, isn't that what video games are all about? I feel like nowadays we're obsessed with perfection. Better graphics, stronger hardware, but isn't that a bit regressive? I'd rather have bad graphics in a bigger world than good graphics in a smaller world. I'm getting off topic, but still, at the time of release, the games got average reviews, and honestly, that's fair. From what I can gather, the original publisher wasn't the best and did like to rush things. I don't want to put the blame on anyone particular, but they don't seem like they were the nicest people. But now that there's a new publisher, they say there's a chance of a new game. Could there be a Blood Rain 3? Or 4, technically? I think so. Devil May Cry just came out of the woodwork, basically perfecting the genre again. And Ninja Gaiden is getting re-released, so I think now would be a perfect time. I would love a new Blood Rain, but it doesn't have to be perfect.
Hell, as far as I'm concerned, they could just have like a cornbread buffet. You know, jalapeno bread, cornbread, Mississippi mud pie bread. That's good. You ever had that? What they do is they have cornbread, right? Then on the inside, they put one of those puddings, right? So they inject the pudding inside. So it's like, it's the only thing that's like a dessert and a roll, right? They should call it corn pudding. You understand what I'm saying? That's a hard name to say. But what I'm saying, that's the kind of restaurant I'm looking for. You know, I don't really, you know, go out much, but I'd go out if they had that.